welcome to Critical Thought TV. I'm Stuart Dambrot, your host. We're here with Dr. Aubrey de Grey, biomedical gerontologist and chief science officer at the SENS Foundation.
Hi.
Welcome. I'm assuming, and nothing pejorative intended, that some of the audience might be associating SENS research with anti-aging and life extension. Mm-hmm. And I would like to ask you to explicate that and make the necessary differentiations where appropriate.
Sure. Okay, so the first thing we need to make clear is that the research that SENS Foundation does and the research that I've done over the years is on the development of medicines that don't yet exist. So we are in no way part of the anti-aging industry trying to sell products that already exist.
I see.
We're PhDs rather than MDs, to put it in one way. Second thing is that we're interested in doing, obviously, a lot more than anyone can do at the moment in terms of postponing age-related ill health. But here's the real key point. The word anti-aging today tends to be used sometimes in a rather pejorative way, actually, in a manner where the whole concept of longevity is central. In other words, it's all about living longer for the sake of living longer. For us, it's not like that. Okay. We're interested in keeping people healthy. And the only reason that there's a lot of interest in the longevity consequences of that in our work is that the way in which we think we can postpone age-related ill health is going to be much more powerful than what anyone else has proposed in the past. And therefore, it's likely to have this side effect of actually allowing people to stay healthy and live longer, a lot longer.
Ah, quite right, quite right.
But it's always important to emphasize that the longevity benefit is a side effect, because otherwise people tend to get into the mindset of thinking, oh dear, I'm going to be old all that time, when in fact it's the other way around.
I've heard that many times. And also, it's quite practical, because life extension without addressing age-related diseases would mean living longer and putting up with those consequences for a longer period of time, which
That's
would actually
right.
not be attractive.
And the good news is that it will also be technically vastly more difficult than what we're trying to do. What we're trying to do, keeping people healthy and having them live longer as a result, is completely, well, it's very hard, but it's far, far easier than keeping someone alive in a really bad state of health.
And it would also, and this is something else I was just about to ask you about, it would shift the focus much more to geriatrics than gerontology, if I understand the term correctly.
This is absolutely right, yes. Geriatrics is all about treating people who are already sick. We do what I sometimes call preventative geriatrics. We're interested in treating people who are getting close to getting sick, maybe, but typically people who are not sick yet.
So as I just mentioned, a very quick look at rejuvenation versus regeneration and retardation as the three primary focal points in this type of research.
Sure. So when people have thought in the past about trying to do preventative geriatrics, trying to postpone the age at which people get sick as a result of having been born a long time ago, they have tended to think in terms of slowing down the rate of accumulation of these various types of molecular and cellular damage that eventually cause those diseases and disabilities. And that makes some kind of sense, because of course we see in the living world a wide variation between species and also even within species in terms of how long an organism stays healthy and how rapidly it ages. So that sort of makes sense, but it turns out that it's really, really hard to map those comparisons onto actual medicine. And we really haven't got anywhere with that so far.
And one example would be calorie restriction, which extends lifespan, but in a way that can actually cause stress to the organism in some ways.
Well, calorie restriction is definitely a very interesting idea, but the main problem is that it looks awfully as though it would actually have a much, much more minor effect on long-lived organisms such as human beings than it does in short-lived organisms like rodents.
I see.
So if we want to do more than that, then we've got to think of something else. Now, the rejuvenation approach, by definition, is not just slowing down the clock of aging, but actually reversing it, actually taking someone who is, let's say, 60 and turning them into someone who's biologically 30 or 40. And the question then is, how would we do that? So the way that SENS Foundation tries to approach this is to do regenerative medicine on aging. Regenerative medicine is something that was actually a term that was actually coined quite some time ago now to describe medical emulation of the sort of natural regeneration that we see in certain organisms, like salamanders, for example, where they can just regrow complex things like, you know, whole limbs or hearts or whatever. And, you know, obviously we can't do that. Medicine could emulate that in principle. And, of course, regenerative medicine has made leaps and bounds over the past decade or so with the creation of, first of all, a variety of different stem cell therapies, mm-hmm. and also the creation of artificial organs, such as new bladders and new livers, hearts, and so on. This is really moving fast now. So then the question is, can we apply regenerative medicine, the principles of regenerative medicine, to aging? And the big insight that I had back in 2000 that's led to SENS Foundation's work was to see that, yes, this could be done, just so long as one took a rather broad definition of regenerative medicine to include not only whole organ level regeneration, like tissue engineering, and not only cellular level regenerative medicine, stem cells, but also molecular level, where we repair the insides of cells, or sometimes we repair the structures, the material that is outside the cell, between cells. And when one takes that somewhat more global definition, that really comes down to restoring the structure and composition of tissues and of the whole body at whether at the molecular level or the cellular level, then it turned out to be pretty straightforward to describe the problem in rather concrete terms as a union of a manageable number of sub-problems.
So, and once again, then, that approach would seem to be vastly simpler than trying to start with the mapping of genotype to phenotype, which is, you know, with epigenetics and methylation, is becoming notoriously complex, much more complex than initially thought.
Right. It's not even necessarily, even if we could perfectly map genotype to phenotype insofar as the mapping exists, that still wouldn't be enough because, of course, as with epigenetic changes and also other environmental changes that don't necessarily even translate into epigenetic changes, you've still got far too much to do. So really going after the damage that is being laid down by the body's normal operation is a much more practical approach.
Thank you so much. Moving now into a couple of specific research projects. One that has always interested me, and I'm going to take advantage of you being here, because it was on the SENS, SENS.org, by the way, the website, as one of the recent projects, having to do with essentially stabilizing or elongating the telomere, which is associated on a correlative basis with aging. Mm-hmm. And if you could talk about that, that'd be great.
Sure. So, more than 50 years ago now, it was discovered that if you take cells out of the skin and you try to grow them and grow them and grow them indefinitely in the lab, then eventually they just shut down and refuse to divide anymore. And this is called replicative senescence. And sometime later, it was established that this is caused by the shortening of the ends of the chromosomes, which are called telomeres. Now, in the human body, cells that need to divide a lot have a mechanism for compensating for this problem of shortening of telomeres during cell division. They express an enzyme called telomerase, which adds DNA back on the ends. But the cells in which this experiment was first done, the cells called fibroblasts, are from the lower layer of the skin, the dermis, where cells don't divide much, except when there's a wound or something like that. And therefore, they don't express this enzyme, and sure enough, if you trick them into dividing a lot anyway, into effectively being in an infinite-sized wound that they can't close, then they get unhappy eventually. So it's remained rather controversial whether telomere shortening actually matters during aging of an actual organism, of a human being. It looks as though it probably does for some specific aspects of aging. The one for which it's the best evidence is the immune system. So the immune system is really important, so that makes that's okay, it's important. However, there's a big catch, which is cancer. It is perfectly clear that in order for cancers to get big enough to kill us, they also have to turn on telomerase, or actually sometimes an alternative mechanism, to extend their telomeres so that they don't hit this replicative senescence. And so there's a big catch-22 here. We've got to find ways to stop cancers from doing that, and we've also got to find ways to rejuvenate any cell types, like in the immune system, where it's happening when we don't want it to. And we've got various tricks to do that. There are, one alternative is essentially to enhance the to stimulate the expression of telomerase so that good things happen like that in the immune system, for example, and then to find other ways to hit cancer on the head and make sure we don't have a problem. Another alternative is to go the other way, to suppress telomerase indiscriminately and cause more problems, exacerbate the problems of telomere shortening elsewhere in the body, and to solve those problems in another way, like with stem cell therapy. And both of those alternatives are being explored. We are exploring the latter in SENS Foundation. Other people are exploring the other one.
Quite right. There are so many research projects to discuss. I wonder if it's possible to very briefly address, you mentioned the immune system, the autoimmune diseases, and in relation to what you write about in terms of AGE, advanced glycation end products.
Okay, so these are two rather separate things, so I'm going to address them one at a time. Autoimmune diseases are actually very closely related to the decline of ability to get rid of foreign antigens, you know, infections. Because in both cases, what's going on is a reduction in the specificity, the precision of the immune system, the ability of the immune system to recognize the difference between what is us and what is not us. And that happens during aging. It happens, of course, in other circumstances too. But in aging, we see increasing what's called oligoclonality. In other words, basically a reduction in the variety of different types of antigen to which the immune system is cognate. We've got, you know, different cells looking at different things. We've got less variety. And if that happens, then it has both of these effects. It weakens the ability of the immune system to fight off infections, and it also weakens the ability of the immune system to suppress itself in the presence of self-antigens, as they're called. So that's an autoimmune disease. So we want to fix that, and by perhaps increasing telomere length in some of the immune cells, but also by other means, we want to rejuvenate the immune system so that neither of these things happen. Now, the question about fast glycation end products and their effects is a different one. It is very relevant to hardening of the arteries, arteriosclerosis, as opposed to atherosclerosis, which is the fatty deposits in the arteries. And this is caused basically because of chemical reactions that join together the proteins that the artery wall is made up of and makes it less elastic, makes it stiffer. It causes hardening, it causes hypertension, and of course that has many downstream effects.
And we should also, in closing, just for the audience, explain the difference between glycation and glycosylation, which is enzyme-based as opposed to glycation, and, at my understanding, and actually is a beneficial process.
Sure. Glycosylation is a process that's been studied for many decades, and it's done on purpose by the body. It's the addition of sugar molecules to certain amino acids in a protein to alter its function or its behavior in one way or another.
Or so there are many markers of
many different ways in which glycosylation is used in the body. Glycation is sort of the same process, the addition of sugar to amino acids, but it happens non-enzymatically, it happens randomly, and sometimes it causes these cross-links that I was talking about that result in stiffening of the extracellular matrix.
Which lead to things like glycated tendonitis, the loss of elasticity in certain connective tissue, that
it's
kind
all
of thing.
About loss of elasticity, that's right, which may cause hypertension if it's in the artery, it may cause an inability to see things close up if it's in the lens of the eye, and so on.
Thank you so much.